For most of her adult life, 40-year-old Sue Durant was part of a Christian fundamentalist cult. It was one of the Revolt Centre International's grouping. But after 18 years, she left, and as she said, she began life again. It was an easy move. It was filled with guilt and fear, and it was complicated by the continuing involvement in the group of her children and husband. Sue Durant joins me now. Welcome.
Hi, Geraldine. Thank you.
Look, I wonder, Sue, your most striking or enduring insight of life inside the cult.
Oh, inside the cult, it was very controlling. It was a very living sort of lifestyle. When I first was 17, in a situation where I'd come from the country to the city, it gave me a chance to feel part of something. It wasn't long, as sort of time went along, I grew a bit sort of suspicious that they didn't reason, that they were in fact very controlling.
And didn't allow you a capacity to grow, in a sense?
Oh, no, definitely not.
And what about, was it a simple life, though? A lot of people yearn for simplicity. Was that fair?
It was certainly a very black and white life. You know, in hindsight, you didn't really have to think too much. Everything was sort of told to you. It was a lifestyle that seemed very family orientated. They had their own camps, they had youth groups, they had, you know, activities galore. And from that sort of point of view, you had sort of, it would appear, your spiritual and your social life all wrapped up in one.
So you didn't have time to brood, by the sound of it.
Oh, no.
Oh, I see.
It was very active.
Idle hands and all that. Or did that go hand in hand with a somewhat traditional arrangement in terms of family life, like, you know, men and women and role of children?
Well, a traditional role in a very archaic sense, as far as the man was the head of the house, the woman was a second-rate citizen, the children, you know, were seen and not heard. You know, it was very, the children were disciplined very strictly.
Were they?
Yes.
For instance?
They believed that if you spared the rod, you spoiled the child.
I see. And when you say women were second-class citizens, give them another example of what you mean.
Well, one example, I suppose, within the church itself was that women were not allowed to hold any particular office. They weren't allowed to, you know, hand out communion or, you know, be a representative of the house leader, perhaps.
If you did feel like disagreeing, were there avenues to do that?
Not really. They say that there are. For myself, I sort of, after she tried to leave over a period of 7 years, it took me that long, if you like, because it was, you were taught that the world was evil and wrong. So, but in that 7 years, I actually grew in my strength to approach people, the oversight, the pastors, and talk with various ones and discuss my difficulties. But I was more or less sort of just put back on the right track and told to sit down and be quiet.
Right. Okay, so you weren't regarded as important enough to seriously worry about that you were in crisis or that you could cause trouble.
I think a few individuals tried, you know, to steer me in the right way, but I think generally, no, I was not considered important enough.
So why did you decide to leave then?
Well, I think as my children got older, you know, that I began to see that if I didn't do something, they were just going to be channeled into this way of thinking. I was fortunate. I'd had an Anglican upbringing, so I had a comparison, whereas a lot of people who grow up in the organisation don't have anything to compare with.
How old were you, by the way, when you got into it?
I was 17 when I joined through a friend at school. Yeah,
and met your husband in there?
I was married by the time the day after I turned 20.
Uh-huh.
So it was they did that intentionally. They're very quick to introduce couples and marry them quickly. And in hindsight, the idea is to keep people in the cult, you know, through this arrangement. But as the children got older, I really began to sort of question that I didn't want them to necessarily follow this path. I wanted them to have other options.
How did you leave, Sue?
I was told in the end that if I left, my children would be taken away from me. And one day I threw a change of underpants to school bags as the children and I went off to school. And I got a friend to drive me to legal aid and I went to a woman's refuge. So it was sort of a overnight sort of thing. Like one minute I was there and the next I wasn't, after thinking through for, like I say, 7 years.
You escaped. I mean, it's...
it sounds awful, doesn't it?
Jumping the Berlin Wall, isn't it? The yeah. important thing is you left without the children.
No.
Oh, you took the children with you.
And at the women's refuge, I spent 8 weeks and I went through deprogramming. Then later on, I tried to sort of maintain our marriage because that was very important to me, but the church made that very difficult. And I am consequently now not my father, and he gets to take the children with him to the revival centre every second weekend.
So you actually, you are the resident parent, as it were?
Yes. Yes.
Was that a court case, by the way?
No, we did manage to, the step before you actually get to court, we managed to sort that out in my favour before it went that far.
Well, that's very impressive. I must say, I would have presumed you may not have been able to do so, given your past.
Yes, I really feel I was very fortunate. A lot of support there through my parents and my family and new friends I managed to make, and that was a very, very hard thing. You know, you are completely ostracised when you leave, and nobody is allowed to have any contact with you.
Sorry to interrupt you, but like you, your parents, what sort of relationship had they maintained you over these 18 years, in a sense?
They were just always there for me, but I hate to say I wasn't there for them. The Revival Centre took over your life completely. You did everything. That was your first priority. But my parents, you know, were there for me, and when I finally did leave, they, were great. They really helped me with lots of things.
What did this deprogramming involve, by the way? You said you had 8 weeks of deprogramming.
Well, not the whole 8 weeks. The time I spent at the refuge, I had the opportunity to go and have deprogrammed through a mainstream church, and it was more sort of like counselling sessions where I could voice my fears. You know, I would tell them about the doctrine that I'd learned and had the opportunity to discuss it and hear other people's opinions and points of view and decide what I thought about it.
So you're painting a picture, Sue, almost of a sort of callow person, you know, that you were not a developed personality by comparison with other people whom you met in the outside world?
I would say that was so. We were taught, we were allowed to socialise within the organisation and have other outside activities, but the whole focus was to meet people so that you could witness to them and bring them into the organisation. So socially I was inept, and educational, I wanted to go back to work part-time when the children got a bit older, and I was not able to do that.
What have been the real dangers, really, in setting up a life, practically speaking?
Finances. The church takes 10% of everything that you earn. You voluntarily give that, but it is very much part of their doctrine that that is necessary for salvation and for an ongoing walk with the Lord. So learning finances, being educated and learning to socialise, I think, are the main sort of things for me.
Learning to socialise?
Yes.
What do you mean?
Within the organisation, it's almost like you speak a separate language. You know, you have things like the baptismal tank and praise the Lord and, you know, those sorts of terms. When you leave, you are taught everybody else is evil, so all of a sudden you have to adapt your thinking and you have to realise that people are very nice. So instead of feeling afraid to meet people, you gain more confidence.
So that you felt almost naive by the sound of it around your peers?
Yes. At school I was quite a good socialiser, but I lost that through the Revival Centre. Even though I had friends within the Revival Centre, you had that common sort of ground. You all had the same gung-ho sort of thought of that. So you didn't discuss, you know, the news or current events. You had a one-track view on homosexuality. You know, it was whatever was taught to you. So, and now I've learnt there are many views and they're different wrong.